An invitation to rise as we come and are called to worship. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world," and his light shines and forever will. So people of the light that shall not be put out, people of the light that shall not be turned off, people of comfort and joy, of inspiration and encouragement, because of that light, Easter people of the risen Christ, let us, with faith, hope, and love, arise and shine, as now we worship God, Creator, Christ, and Spirit, one God, blessed Trinity, world without end. Welcome to worship, everyone. Let us sing of the power of God's love. Please be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, present in your risen power through Christ your Son, help us by your word and spirit to be for you as you are for us. Bless us, we pray, this morning here in sanctuary and together by live streaming as we offer and enjoy our daily life and worship. Arise in our hearts. Fan our faith, inspire our worship, lift our praise, guide our proclamation. Hear our prayers, O Lord, as we gather to celebrate and learn of the power of your love. Ever in the light of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we ask that you reveal to us where we fall short in proclaiming your glory and being for him. Those times we have chosen to live in darkness instead of in the light, those places where we have failed to shine for you, those opportunities we have missed to breathe your life into our lives and our communities and our world, that which is our sin against you, creation, neighbor, and self, for it, all of it, we are sorry. By the cross of our Savior, we make confession of it, that of recent times and of times long gone that burdens us still. Merciful God, lead us back into your warm embrace that we may be the same. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord, who taught us as one to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Sincere people, people of wisdom, of truth, of trust, and of faith, the promise of God declares, I shall give you a new heart and put a new and right spirit within you. I will cause you to walk according to my ways, so you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Beneath the cross in front of the tomb, both empty, into the very depths of your being has come the life-changing, amazing grace of God. Let it be new for you today. Let it renew you and restore you afresh to fully live as one created in the image of God, to be for the profound goodness of God. Friends, believe, trust, and be glad. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. You are free to love even as you are loved. The peace of your Savior be with you and through you. Thanks be to God. Amen. We greet one another in the Lord's name today with a warm welcome to Trinity Church, a welcome here to the sanctuary, this beautiful church home, and welcome here through the wonders of live streaming. We're glad to be together in the unity of the Spirit. On the back page of the bulletin today, I've highlighted these things, and I'll just note them together with you. We have a fellowship and refreshment time after church, the long-standing tradition of this congregation. Thanks to everyone who brings it to life. A very special time today, Ruth, as we will acknowledge your 90th birthday, which happens tomorrow. There'll be a cake and some singing of happy birthday. So if we can make our way to the North Hall and be together in the Lord, and especially be together with Ruth. Congratulations, our friend. You are a beacon of all that it means to say, here I am, Lord. You are a bright light shining when it comes to following the one that you trust now and even forevermore. Thank you for your love, your laughter, your joy in Jesus. We look forward in time of celebration with you after worship today. Church school, Liz, as always, thank you. The road to Emmaus today, after the children's story, the children are invited to North Hall to learn more about that amazing walk that the disciples and some other people took on a road there to meet Jesus. We note that this Wednesday, April 17th, we have a special guest, Christina from Hope Air. What an amazing name for an organization. It's Canada's only charity offering free travel and accommodations for Canadians in financial need who must access medical care far from home. Lunch Bunch took a wee break over the fullness of the Easter, Holy Week and Easter seasons, but with Joan and Melvin and Michael back at it, and Rania here with Christina on Wednesday, it follows the exercise and friendship time with Isabel and friends here in the Doig Room, and right after that time on Wednesday to the North Hall for the Lunch Bunch with Hope Air. We look out on next Sunday. It was Bob Bray's vision that we would have an Earth Day, and it transformed into a Teddy Bear Sunday. Some people brought their teddy bears this week to have them ready for next week. Teddy bears, stuffed animals, welcome next Sunday. We're going to have a very special guest. You may remember from two editions of Ministry Moment during the season of the pandemic, Robin Howard was featured in two of them, a remarkably gifted friend, leader in the church up at Camp Cairn Family of Camps. She'll be here in worship leadership with Michael and myself and Bob next Sunday. Bring your teddy bears. Bob's also offering a walk on the wild side, an Easter Day celebration hike and midday snack at Rouge National Park on the 24th. And we note that our annual spring retreat on the 27th is with the Reverend John Borthwick, a long-serving minister of the Presbyterian Church in Canada and recently appointed as the Director of Lifelong Learning at Knox College. And he'll be offering our retreat, 8:30 a.m. breakfast, 9 o'clock, a cold stop at noon, Empathy in a Hardly Hearing World, April 27th. And we note the Sacrament of Holy Baptism to be administered on the 28th. If anyone would like to make further inquiry, please feel free to contact me. Welcome all to worship here from here. Thanks be to God for such a time as this. The invitation to rise to sing a camp song, a good spring song, It Only Takes a Spark. Please be seated and invite the children to come here to the chancel steps. And yes, next Sunday's Teddy Bear Sunday, and we think about all the bears out in the forest and hope they had a good winter. And yes, next Sunday we'll welcome Robin Howard from Cairn Family of Camps, and I know some of you have been up there in recent times. I know that some of you were up to Karen Family of Camps and the combination of camps that came together. You've been up there a while ago. Some of you fell madly in love there and married and had three daughters, and oh my goodness. So we give thanks for camps. And at camp, there is the building of a campfire. And I wanted to just be about building a campfire with you while acknowledging Bill, Convener of Facilities and Grounds, that I have water here. There's lots of water should this campfire not go as expected. But to build a campfire, well, there are different ways to do it. I was astounded. There's that way and 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 that way. Only we could make a science out of building a campfire. But I'd like to build what's called a log cabin campfire. And it's one of these and one of these and one of these and one of these. And you put the paper in the middle like this. And then, see? It's like this. There's different ways to do it, but this is called a log cabin campfire. And then you take this, and then you go like this, and you light the fire theoretically. There. But just imagine that this has become a beautiful fire. There's one down by the beach, maybe at Camp Cairn. And the big fires, it burns. And it gets to be just a little bit of a fire. And over time, you may have to give it a little poke, right? Just give it a little poke so it keeps on burning. This is be better if I turn it around. There. A little, it's called a poker. It's a little pokey thing, isn't that? Thank Mr. Heron and Mrs. Heron for bringing this along. And that can get the fire going a little bit more. And then, you know, it's still going to burn down and down and down. That big, huge fire that we started, and it was just burning and burning and burning. And it got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. It goes down and down and down and down and down and down and down. You might have to give it a poke to keep it going, and then it gets lower. And then you might even have to blow on it. That's the thing that sometimes people do. There's that guy. Borrowed my hat, borrowed my shirt. Just keep blowing, but it still may keep going down and down and down. And then you're at a point of decision. With your fire, you have to decide. You might check your watch, 10:51:26, and think, "Oh boy, I better pour this water on the fire to get it all snuffed out. I've got to go to bed in my tent. I got to get back in my canoe. I've got to get on my way. It's just time to snuff out that fire." So you pour a little bit of water. Or you're at this crossroads, you've had this fire, it's been burning, and got big, and then it got small, and then it got down to embers, and then you blew on it, and you poked it, and you're at a crossroads. You add water to it to snuff it out, or you stoke the fire, but you need to have more wood. Oh my goodness, well thank you. I wanted you to carry it like this. There.
Wow.
So there's more wood, and then you put more wood on the fire, and you got more wood from a friend, which is really nice. And you put more wood on the fire, and it carries on. It carries on. Trinity Church, precious children of God. You know, back in about 1949 and officially in 1953, the fire, it's Trinity Church, it started to burn and bring a warm embrace, an amazing grace to York Mills and beyond. And it keeps going and it keeps going and it keeps going because people, there comes times in the life of church and there comes time in the life of living for Jesus that we might need just a little just a little poke, or maybe a whoosh, 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 to get going again, or maybe some more wood. And we give thanks today for 71 years of this church's life and for every year of your life that someone has taken time and someone has made effort, thanks be to God, to light the spark of Jesus Christ alive in our lives, to place wood on the fire to keep us alive for Jesus, to give us a little wee poke along the way, one of those, and to add more wood. Stoke the fire that through every season of this congregation's life and our life as friends in Christ, we'll just keep on burning for him. Thanks be to God for camp. Thanks be to God for campfires. Thanks be to God for a little poke and stoking and friends who help us to shine brightly for Jesus. And with Michael and Liz and everyone here, thank you, everyone, for the way that you help Trinity Church, help Jesus be a bright light shining to each other and to this world. Let us pray. Dear God, thanks for camp and campfires. Thank you for everyone who has shone their light upon us.
Thank you for everyone who has shone their light on us.
Especially Jesus.
Keep us shining.
As church.
As individuals.
In all of life.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. It can stay there. Sometimes it is so easy to pick a hymn. Remaining seated, let us sing 496, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet.
My word is a lamp.
share together this morning two readings from the Bible, one from the Old Testament and one from the New. Reading first from Isaiah 50. The Lord has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. Luke 24, 36 to 48. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Thanks be to God for these readings from God's own most holy word. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Oh, it might have been camp, something else. There's nothing like the memory of a happy and meaningful time. We take photos and videos to keep such times alive, even well after they have gone. Some of us tuck these things away, these photos and videos and memories. Others of us fill the walls of our home with them or pop them up on a screen for viewing at a special time. One way or another, they serve as reminders of days before that inspire these days. Trinity's devoted archivist, Rania, like Barbara before her, is our amazing keeper of these things for Trinity Church. Our archives are excellent, and we're fortunate that this is so. Not only is found in the archive room downstairs, but also now on the World Wide Web. The archives are such a force for good as they remind us and teach us that each year of this congregation's life is built upon the years before. Each moment of this congregation's life is built upon the moments before. Trinity Church, ever onward, in Christ grounded, Easter alive, faith, hope, and love. I have, like you, many pictures of many happy and meaningful times. Myself on the hearth of the fireplace of 118 Steele Street, Barrie, Ontario, our family home for 26 years. I'm about 3 years old, and I'm sitting there holding a hammer, and I don't know quite what I was doing with it. I have a picture of my father in the 30s, tough times in the 30s. He's just a little boy with his pony. I have a picture of my mom as a little girl with her dad who died in 1941 when she was 9. I have a picture of my big brother Mark and I playing hockey in the backyard in Barrie, circa the winter of 71. I have a picture of Nancy at my 16th birthday. Thanks for showing up for my 63rd. I have a picture of the first house that Nancy and I made a home. Pictures of the children arriving and leaving and coming back with more than they left with things and people. Pictures of our three dear dogs, Spirit, Farley, Moses. I have pictures of you. Beautiful photos, beautiful videos of you. All of these and more bringing such comfort and joy, inspiration and encouragement. I look at those photos and those videos, or even just think about them, and my heart is warmed. Like it is when you go through the archives of Trinity Church. Soon, there will be photos of our first grandchild. Today, right about now, is the due date. You know, photos and videos and all those things that remind us of who we are and whose we are, from where we came and helping us as we go. Oh, and even if the photos and the videos are for some reason no more and the memory for some reason fades, still and forever, the comfort and the joy, the inspiration and the encouragement they brought, even as the ones who in the photos and the videos brought them, will not. Rania will always love Trinity, as will we. My father will always love his pony. My mom will always love her dad. My brother and I will always love hockey. I will always love Nancy and the kids and the dogs. We need these memories. We need these photos and videos and history books and stories passed down from generation to generation. Wings, please tell Esther, and Esther, if you're watching from BC, I love it, Esther, when you tell us about Betty Worthington. Some of you knew her. I did not. I wish I did. I love it, Esther, when you tell us about Betty Worthington and her big hug embracing you when you arrived here from a country far away in 1970. You tell that story even now because it matters so much. I love telling the story of the Reverend Dr. Jim Zagletti bouncing down the chancel steps here to embrace Nancy and me when we first visited you on February 23rd, 2014, a short 10 years ago. Oh, and yes, even if the photos and the videos are for some reason no more, and the memory for some reason fades, still and forever, the comfort and the joy, the inspiration and the encouragement they brought, even as the ones who in the photos and the videos brought them, will not. In our passage from Luke, Jesus was in his own way bringing comfort and joy and encouragement and inspiration to his disciples. He was especially doing so with the hope of having his disciples deepen their trust and their faith in him as the Son of God and the risen Savior of the world. Jesus was finding ways to help the disciples deepen their trust and faith in the truth that they were loved to love, precious children of God. People are talking in our passage. They had been talking in the passages just before this one too, talking about Jesus. Is he really this? Did he really do that? Can he be who he says he is? What happens if he is not? The same characters that are present in our passage, the same ones talking away, are the ones that we find also in the road to Emmaus and at the table. They were talking then and they're talking now about Jesus. We find them here in our passage discussing the evidence of the risen Lord and how all of this relates to references about Moses and all the prophets. They were talking about the prophetic witness of holy sacred words to the Savior. And then during their discussion, just imagine they're talking there. They thought that they were seeing a ghost when they first saw Jesus after his resurrection to life. Just imagine having a conversation about someone, their legitimacy, their reality, their essence, their hope, their being, their whatever, the promises they make, the purposes they have, the teachings they have. You're talking about them, and boom, they're right there. It's as if you'd seen a ghost. Fair enough. They recognize before them Jesus, but they're not quite ready to fully accept him, to let him in. Is it Jesus? Yes, it is. Really, indeed, it is. And he's with them. And by being with them again, and by talking to them and listening to them, Jesus found a powerful way to fan their faith, to tell them he was with them always, a living story, an endless truth arising in their hearts. And as we heard and we can hear again, Luke describes this encounter between Jesus and his followers as being pretty intense. The word frightened is used, the word doubt is used, and the word heart is used. The frightened and the doubt we can get. But what about the heart? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Jesus asks his disciples. Jesus wanted to help his disciples have an inner commitment to his good news, a commitment that touched them and moved them and helped them be all that they could be as children of God and people of the resurrection of the Son of God. He wanted them to take him to heart. He wanted them to take him to heart. That is why he showed them what he showed them, hands, feet, and told them what he told them. And they struggle to understand and interpret all of this. Their hearts were troubled. There was so much talk. He was gone, and now he's back. And Jesus knows where they're at, and he knows how they're feeling. And he provides those two proofs of his bodily existence, as evidence of his resurrection, his hands, his feet. He's trying so hard, trying in every way that he can, to comfort them and give them joy, inspire them and encourage them for holy living. And through those efforts, through those words and those ways and those actions and that presence, they come to realize that he is alive beyond the grave. He is Jesus. And their faith strengthens more and more. The truth of his resurrection and the importance of God's plan strike home in their hearts more deeply within them. And their hearts begin to arise. Seeing Jesus, touching Jesus, hearing Jesus, having a meal with Jesus, reading about Jesus, watching Jesus' love and people love for him helped the disciples understand how God's past, present, and future work together for salvation and the bringing in real ways the good news of God's love in Christ to life in their life. And from their living. That was then in Luke 24. That intense moment. And the result of all of this, the result of the resurrection of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, the disciples and all other followers of Jesus go out bearing witness and effectively spread the message of the resurrection of Jesus and with it the triumph of love over hate and life over death. And from there, the disciples with Jesus, the disciples bearing witness, and from there, well, from there comes the Acts of the Apostles, the fifth book of the New Testament, which tells all about the remarkable life of the early church. A great book. And from there comes Rania and her Trinity Church archives in the basement and in the cloud. And from there, we have a warm embrace of Esther by Betty in 1970, and Kirk and Nancy by Jim in 2014, and we pray someone new here today by someone old here today for over and over within and from 2737 Bayview Avenue, York Mills, faith fanned by people who loving Jesus, loved for Jesus. Loved for Jesus by being at a meeting in person or on Zoom. Loved for Jesus by being an officer, a representative, a convener, a counter, a member, an elder. Loved for Jesus by singing, by playing. Loved for Jesus by live streaming and sound boothing, by North Hall hosting, by sweeping, by shoveling, by cooking, by driving, by teaching, by visiting, by visioning, by praying, and in your heart wanting the best, by doing your best you can. Loved for Jesus by saying, "Here I am, Lord, knowing you are for me." You, resurrected you, knowing that you are for me, you, Son of God, Savior, Lord, and friend, knowing that you are for me, I ask, how can I be for you? We ask, how can we be for you? Absolutely, Jesus Christ was the first fantastic fanner of faith. Absolutely for him, let us be fantastic fanners too, like others were when they did the same for us. Fanning faith, certain of Christ's message of salvation, abundant life, eternal life, and love for God, neighbor, and self. Fanning faith, hopeful in him as the resurrected Son of God and Savior of the world, such that love will win. Love will win, and death will lose its sting. Increasing the strength of belief by blowing on it and stirring up the air near it. That's fanning. Fanning, increasing the strength of belief by blowing on it and stirring up the air near it. Jesus for us, us for Jesus, fanning the faith. Remember those photos and videos in your life and mine, those photos and videos and other pieces of memorabilia that give us comfort and joy and encouragement and inspiration? Trinity Church, the camera is on you. Smile. Smile as you, with trust and faith in Jesus, create for one another and all others memories of such comfort and joy, such encouragement and inspiration. Yeah, remember those photos and videos and other pieces of memorabilia that give us these things, such comfort and joy and encouragement and inspiration. Trinity Church, the camera is on you. Smile. Smile as in endless ways you live, fanning faith in Jesus, who is always doing the same for you. And the grass, it withers, and the flower, it fades, but the word of the Lord shall stand forever. Amen. The Apostle Paul, he wrote about 13 of the 27 letters in the New Testament. And here's a little bit of his second letter at the 9th chapter to the church at Corinth, 2 Corinthians 9 at verse 8. God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. For all the grace abounding in the life of Trinity Church, past, present, and yet to be, for all the good work of this congregation, past, present, and yet to be, we give thanks. We give thanks for all the gifts of time and talent and treasure. We give thanks for each other and for God's will and work alive in us. We give thanks for all the offerings that we have received and all the offerings that we have given. An invitation to rise and sing with gratitude and with hope and with faith. Please be seated, and some words from Linda Herron, Clerk of Session.
Good morning. In my role as Clerk of Session, I received correspondence directed to the congregation. I have received a piece of correspondence from Kirk, which he will now share.
Thank you. I said earlier that sometimes it's easy to pick hymns. Sometimes things are not so easy. So I write to you, dear people of Trinity Presbyterian Church, York Mills. Thank you for every expression of kindness and support you've extended to me, to Nancy, and to our family. Being your minister will remain one of the greatest joys and greatest privileges of my life. I'm grateful for everything we have done and everything we have been together for Christ. Now the time has come for me to go. I look forward to greeting new chapters in my life, even as I abound in gratitude for the chapter that we have written together over the last 10 years. Sunday, June 30th, 2024, is set to be my final Sunday with you, pending approval by the Presbytery of East Toronto, to whom I report. Following accumulated time, August 15th, 2024, is set to be my last official day. Opportunities may come about for me within the Presbyterian Church in Canada. It is for this reason that I've asked the Presbytery to consider my request to resign as opposed to retire. The Presbytery, together with the session, will ensure that things happen as they should as I prepare to leave and when I am gone. I have deeply enjoyed my time with you. I'm so happy to have been in your company for a decade of my life and yours. I'm proud of you, and I always will be. You are a great and beautiful congregation. My affection for you will be forever. May you always know and be God's amazing grace and warm embrace. Trinity Church, thank you for everything. Trinity Church, in the love of Christ, Savior, Lord, and friend, with you, I remain. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you, Kirk. I know that this will come as a surprise to you all. Session was advised on Tuesday evening of Kirk's plan to resign as of August 15th, with his last Sunday being June 30th. Please know that the Human Resources Ministry met on Thursday and will be presenting an outline of the next steps to Session as we at our regular meeting on Tuesday. Please know that the staff will be well cared for during this time of transition. As I've had time to reflect since Kirk shared his decision with me, I know that we will be sad that he's leaving as our minister, and we will miss him greatly. But we can and will celebrate the wonderful decade we've shared together. There'll be cake. Kirk will be leaving Trinity in a good and stable place. Together, we will faithfully discern our path, and all will be well as God's plan unfolds for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of life and the joy of sharing it together in Christ your Son. We thank you that by word, spirit, and church, we can draw near to you always in every season of life through cloud and sunshine, in sorrow and in joy. Through you, we are blessed by the resurrection of Jesus and the promise of new life in him and for him. Help us always to live this blessing to your glory and for your goodness. Help us to follow Jesus all the way. As you invite us to, we bring you our prayers here as we can anywhere at any time. We pray for people who are victims of discrimination and acts of hatred, invasion, exclusion, violence, war. May your desire for justice be made known and lived out. And in this, in every way, may we, as church, as disciples, be for you. We pray for people who are struggling with illness or sadness, with pain and worry, for themselves, for someone else they love so much. We pray for people who do not have enough food or water, who seek clothing and shelter, who long for dignity, peace, or purpose. We pray for every caregiver in every expression of compassion. And we pray for everyone who is grieving and who mourns so much because a loved one has died. O Lord, may all lives be touched by the power of resurrection, and with it hope and pure wonder of receiving and giving your love now and forever. We pray for all people here and the world over who in your spirit make up your church. May we with them be for the good of all with our words and ways, gladly being your Easter people, fanning faith in your good news of a love that will not let us go. We pray for our families, our friends, and ourselves. May we know the power of your compassion and live confidently and kindly for Jesus. Hear our prayer, O God, for this ever faithful and precious flock, now aware of change, and even more as always, immensely aware of and trusting your grace and your guiding hand. Keep Trinity smiling, O Lord. Keep Trinity serving. Keep Trinity as one alive in your life for life. We ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake, united with all at peace in your eternal care. All glory, honor, and praise be to you, dear God, through the friendship of our Lord. Amen. Faith is to be sure of the things we hope for and certain of the things that we cannot see. We live by faith. Let us sing. And now, may the love of God and the grace and peace of our Savior, Lord, and friend, Jesus Christ, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with each one of you and all of God's people this day and even forevermore.